The message this morning is the second half of the Ten Commandments. We talked about the first half last week, the part that talks about loving God, the first four commandments. Now today, the last six commandments have to do with loving others. But we're going to begin in the New Testament, John chapter 7, verse 14. And then he says something at the end of this passage that is absolutely astounding, and I think you'll see what it is. Not until halfway through the feast did Jesus go up to the temple courts and began to teach. The Jews were amazed and asked, "How did this man get such learning without having studied?" Jesus answered, "My teaching is not my own. It comes from him who sent me. If anyone chooses to do God's will, he will find out whether my teaching comes from God or whether I speak on my own. He who speaks on his own does so in order to gain honor for himself, but he who works for the honor of the one who sent him is a man of truth. There is nothing false about him. Has not Moses given you the law? Yet not one of you keeps the law. Why are you trying to kill me?" Isn't that an amazing statement? Has not Moses given you the law? And yet not one of you keeps the law. Some man will pipe up and say, "I have." And yet Jesus Christ himself, our Lord, who is the way, the truth, and the life, looked at the Jews and he says, "Moses has given you the law, and yet not one of you keeps the law." Romans chapter 3, verse 23, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Romans 3:10 says, "As it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one." None righteous, no, not one. Ecclesiastes 7:20, Solomon was making this observation. He says, "There is not a righteous man on earth who does what is right and never sins." The teachings of Jesus have clarified and do clarify the law, so that we may clearly see, if we'll just open our eyes, we can clearly see that none of us keeps it perfectly. For when he talks about, "You have heard it was said, you shall not commit murder," I say to you, whoever is angry in his heart with his brother is guilty of murder. "You have heard it said that you shall not commit adultery. But I say to you, whoever looks upon a woman to lust after her has committed adultery already in his heart." And throughout his ministry, he teaches and clarifies. As we spoke last week, he wipes the steam off of the mirror that we have built up on the mirror, taking our religious baths, our religious showers. And we've steamed up the mirror of the Word of God, the law. And we can't see ourselves and we think that we're okay. But Jesus cleans that mirror off and lets us see ourselves. Jesus Christ is the only person who has ever kept all of the law. And that's why it's important that we understand who Jesus is, that he was the Son of God, that he was a perfect Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. You cannot go around teaching like so many denominations today do, that Jesus was just another guy, that he had all kinds of loose morals. This is honestly being taught, even in our own denomination. You can go to our bookstore and find a book called Our Queer Jesus. And that is how people are depicting him. But Jesus Christ has to be the perfect Son of God, or he cannot be Savior. He cannot be qualified to pay the price of our sins. So he must be the perfect Lamb of God, the Son of God. In him, the law was fulfilled, so that now that he is in us through faith, God looks upon us and he sees that the righteous requirements of the law are fulfilled in us who live in Christ by faith through the Holy Spirit. And since we live in the Spirit, we must also learn to walk in the Spirit, keeping our faith strong in that finished work of Jesus Christ for us through his death and his resurrection. That's walking in the Spirit, keeping our faith strong in Him, no matter what our failures may be. Christians who walk in the Spirit maintain a poor in spirit approach to life. And that's why Jesus gave the Beatitudes. Blessed are the poor in spirit, the humble. They're humble because they know. They're repentant because of the sins that they've committed and that they continue to commit. They mourn. Blessed are those that mourn. They shall be comforted. They mourn because they know how far they are off. They've missed the mark. We understand that we are sinners, that we must often ask forgiveness in Jesus' name. And we learn how to do that. We learn how to ask forgiveness of other people. I hope we do. After I became a Christian, suddenly the Lord began to smite me with poorness of spirit and a mournfulness and a humility. And I would begin to ask my brother to forgive me. And so the law is important for us to see clearly so that we might understand our own sin and become more humble. The Bible says that we ought to meditate upon the law. David exalted God's law throughout Psalm 119. It goes through the entire Hebrew alphabet. It has a paragraph for letter A, letter B, letter C, Aleph, Beit, Gimel, Dalet, Hey, Vav, Zayin. So those were the alphabet letters. And so if you go to verse 97, he says, "Oh, how I love your law. I meditate on it all day long." Boy, amazing. All day long. What the word meditate means to ruminate. It's like when a cow eats grass, they go and they sit down and one stomach handles it and then they burp it up, and then they swallow it, and another stomach. That's rumination. That's what we are to do with God's word, God's law. We're to ruminate, constantly be calling it up and ruminating on it, redigesting it, trying to understand it better and better. Sometimes when I go swimming, I count my laps off by thinking about the Ten Commandments. I go lap one, "You shall have no other gods before me." Lap number two, "You shall have no graven images." Lap number three, "Do not take the name of the Lord your God in vain." Lap number four, "Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy." Lap number five, "Honor your father and your mother." Number six. And so years and years ago, I memorized the Ten Commandments using little memory pegs. So you can ask me, "Oh, what's the ninth commandment?" I think, "Nine wine." And there's a bear. "Do not bear false witness." He's got wine. It's a little story in my mind. So you can ask me, what is commandment number seven? Seven heaven. A guy climbs a beanstalk, he gets up to heaven, and it says, "No adults allowed." The commandment is, "Thou shalt not commit adultery." Ten, den. There's a little den with bears in it. It's got little coverings. They're called covets. "Thou shalt not covet." These little stories. And so I meditate upon these laws, and as I swim that lap, I say, "Lord, forgive me for not honoring my mother and my father. Why, Lord, have I not honored my father and my mother?" It's because at some point you start feeling superior to your mother and your father. You're just flat better than they are. You know more than they do. They're not very smart. They're not very technological. They don't know very much. You're just better than they are. And so I meditate and I learn why it is I did not honor my father and my mother. I think, well, why do I covet? It's because I think I deserve something. I covet what other people have because I think I deserve it. I think I'm deserving. Why do I dishonor God? I dishonor His name. I set up images in my own life and I dishonor His Sabbath day. Why do I do those things? It's because I think I want to ascend where God is. This whole chapter, chapter 119 of Psalms, is all about the wonders and the splendors of God's law, His statutes, His testimonies, and how it can bless your life and direct you and make your life happy. So we're to meditate upon it. Joshua was told by God, he said, "Tell the people, this book of the law will not depart out of your mouth." You're not going to forget this. You're not ever going to stop talking about this. "It shall not depart from you, but you shall meditate therein day and night, For then you shall make your way prosperous, then you shall have good success. So when we talk about meditating on the law and thinking about what it means and how it is divided into two parts, you know, love God and love your neighbor, I want to share a little vision with you. I shared a vision last week with you. Here's another one. In the last days, your young men shall see visions, your old men shall dream dreams. So I guess that means I'm still a young man because I'm seeing visions instead of dreaming dreams. So here's my latest vision about the law. Imagine a trophy of a basketball player. It has a three-tiered base. You know how they are? Sometimes there's like three steps, a big base, then a little bit smaller. And the three tiers of that trophy stand for, number one, pride. That's at the base of all sin. Pride is at the base of every sin that we commit. The next tier is self-love. We just love ourselves so much. And then on the top of that is disregard. We disregard God and we disregard other people because we love ourselves so much because we are so proud. And on top of this three tiers of the causes of sin is a basketball player, and he has three sections. The lower part, the legs, is labeled, I will ascend. Like Satan said, I will ascend and I will be like the Most High. I will be honored. I will be worshipped. I will be first. And that is why we violate the first four commandments. Have no other gods, make no images, do not profane God's name, and hallow the Sabbath day. That's why we violate those four, is because we will ascend. And it doesn't matter what God says and who He is. I'm going to do what I want to do, when I want to do it, to achieve what I want, and I will ascend. I'll be good. I'll be great. I'll be successful. And it doesn't matter if God wants some honor. I'm going to tell bad jokes so I can be in with the crowd and be successful. Doesn't matter if God wants a special day for Himself. I'm going to join the team and I'm going to do whatever I want to do when I want to do it so I can be successful and do what I want to do. I will ascend. And then the midsection of this basketball player, the torso, is called I Am Superior. And that's why we break the next three commandments. Honor your parents. I'm superior to my parents. This is a vision in my mind I need to share with you. I was driving down Highway 75 in Dallas, Texas. I was on my way to a job. My oldest daughter had just called me and needed bailed out. And so I had just delivered a ton of money to her. And I was driving down the highway and I said to myself, you know, my dad never did that for me. And I just got angry with my dad. He'd been dead for like 10 years. But I was getting angry with my dad for not ever doing something like that for me. And something told me, something whispered in my ear and said, you are going to regret this. You know? And it was not long before I had more family problems than you could shake a stick at. And I did regret feeling superior to my father. And that is also why we kill. You know what? I am so much more superior than those liberals in Washington that I dream about robots that I can create to go kill them all. I'm so superior to the other Republicans, you know, that I'm going to grab a gun and go shoot them all. I am so superior to the idiots who think this and think that, that I have this animosity, this anger, that I would just as soon kill them as to look at them. Get rid of them, like Lenin did. Just go, they're the enemies of the people, let's just kill them all. Because I'm superior. And that's why we commit adultery. You know what? I just got more love in me than one person can handle. And I'm just going to spread my love around. That's how superior I am. But little do you know, when you do that, you're robbing from your wife or your husband that which belongs to them and you do it because you think you are superior. And then there's the upper section, the head. So we have, I will ascend, I am superior, and then the top is, I deserve. And it violates the last three commandments. Do not steal. Why do people steal? I deserve that. You don't deserve that. You don't need that. I need that. I deserve it. Why do I lie? It's because I'm the one who deserves honor. I'm the one that deserves a higher place. And so I'll lie about you. I'll lie about anything to protect my image, to protect my place. I lie because I think I deserve something. That's why I covet other people's things. I deserve that. I deserve it. Now, this basketball player is on this three tiers of pride, of self-love, and of disregard. And he's got this lower part. He's got this middle part. He's ready to shoot the ball, but he's blind. And he shoots the ball at four different goals. You remember those basketball courts in school? They'd have a goal here and a goal there and a goal there and a goal there. So here he is. He's blind. He's on this terrible foundation, and he's got all this problem. And he's going to shoot. And he shoots at all four, and he misses all four goals. The baskets are called this: the personal goals, the political goal, the institutional goal, and the industrial goal. Because of our blindness and our unknowing violations of God's law, we always miss the goal. That's what hamartia means. For all have sinned, for all have hamartia'd. And it means literally to miss the mark. We have all missed the mark. And when we miss the personal goal, we become personally dishonored. Right? Right? Come on now.
Right.
When you sin, when you break God's commandments, when you're full of pride and self-love and disregard for God and others, you miss the mark of your personal goal and you are dishonored. You feel it? Been there? Everybody that's been there, say amen.
Amen.
The next goal is the political goal. And every person and every society all through history shoots the basket at the political goal. And we miss and we become politically divided. It is inevitable. We are divided politically. Oh, but you know what? I'm so much superior to you. You just don't think straight, right? One time I preached a sermon when I was young and stupid. Now I'm just old and stupid. But when I was young and stupid, I preached this sermon and I said, you can't vote this way and be a Christian. The next day, somebody came into my office, sat down and said, Pastor, you just think you know everything, don't you? I'll never forget those words. Politically divided. We can't put our divisions aside, because we're so proud, because we're so self-love, we're in love with ourselves, because we have such disregard for other people. And we will ascend, and we will be superior, and we deserve. That is why we are politically divided, friends. There's the personal, there's the political, there's another one, there's the institutional. I'm talking about in the institutions of education, institutions of our society. And we miss that goal too because of our sin. We are institutionally dysfunctional because of our sins. Human sinfulness renders every single institution dysfunctional. Personally, I believe our educational system today is 98% dysfunctional. This is the most amazing school system I've ever been a part of, right here. I think a lot of it is because we keep the Word of God in it. But you go to colleges today, and it was on the news the other day, you can't even speak your mind anymore. It is all censored. You have to fit right into a little mold, and they have molded themselves into oblivion, and they're being dismantled one institution at a time. We are institutionally dysfunctional with every single institution in our society. And last of all, we are industrially destructive. Industrially destructive. Our sinfulness produces industry that destroys. That's what we are. I spent several years being a paint contractor. Had all the equipment, hired a bunch of guys who knew how to paint, did a bunch of professional painting. Uncle Sam came in and he said, boys, we're going to ask you to save all of your dirty paint thinner and put it in a 55-gallon drum. And then you're going to call us, we're going to come around and pick it up, and we're going to charge you $550 to pick that up. And of course, they would take that then and recycle it and sell it and make money on it. Well, guess what the painters did instead? Threw all of their dirty paint thinner right down the drains. It ended right up in our water supply, in our farm ground. We are industrially destructive, and industries will destroy lives and destroy towns because of the almighty dollar, because they deserve and they are superior and they will ascend and they are proud and they are self-loved and they are disregarding. We miss the goal. We miss the mark. We are personally dishonored, politically divided, institutionally dysfunctional, and industrially destructive. But something is missing from this picture, and truly, we do have to maintain humility and some pretty low expectations of ourselves and others. But there is somebody else on the basketball court, and he is the go-to shooter of the entire universe. We can't see him, but we can hear his voice and we can pass the ball in his direction. And when we do that, we are confessing our sins, we're confessing our blindness, we're confessing our disability. And the good news, friends, is that Jesus always, always, always catches the ball. And he always, always, always makes the shot. He never misses. He wins the game every time for all of eternity. His name is Jesus. I just want to read three verses. John 6:37. Everyone that the Father gives me shall come to me, and whoever comes to me I will in no wise cast out. Are you blind like I am? Have you missed every goal you've ever shot at? Are you standing on a foundation of sin? Are you made up of sin itself? Come to Jesus. He will in no wise cast you out. John 5:24. Verily, verily, I say to you, he that hears my word and believes on him that sent me has everlasting life and shall never come into judgment. You'll never come to be judged. You've bypassed judgment. You've passed from death unto life. Isn't that a great verse? Verily, verily, I say to you, he that hears my word and believes on him that sent me has everlasting life, shall never come into condemnation, but is passed from death to life. And then Romans 5:8, for God commended his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Let's pray. I hope that you'll pray this prayer. Heavenly Father, I come to Jesus for help.